In this video, we're going to be working on the 2014 Ram Sport. It's got a 5.7 liter Hemi, and if you listen closely, you might be able to hear the infamous Hemi Tick. Here we have the truck loaded up on the trailer and ready to head south. We're going to get underway.
Hello everyone, I'm here with my 2014 Dodge Ram Sport. As you can see, I've got the 7-inch premium cluster. I've got a little bit of an issue where the screen is blank and occasionally flashes the snow white background, just like that. I haven't seen a lot of information on this issue yet. If any of you have any and you want to get in touch with me, that'd be great. I'd love to know a little bit more about it. Otherwise, I'm going to start looking into this and see what type of solutions I can come up with, and I will be happily passing them on. Let's see how inexpensively we can get the repairs done, and hopefully it's not too bad.
Now, my 2014 Dodge Ram Sport, we've touched on the instrument cluster, and now we're going to start looking at the engine. It has the common Hemi problem where it's got a tick to it. Likely it's wiped out the cam or it's got a collapse lifter. I did do some research, dug into the engine a little bit. Let me just swing the camera around and show you what I found.
Okay, here we go. As you can see, I've pulled the valve covers off the engine. This side's rather easy to get to. I'll just turn the camera a little bit. Right here, number 4 cylinder, right there. You can see how nice and loose. Should not be like that. The rest of them are pretty good. We're going to go through all of them. This is your exhaust valve on this side. And you can see the play and the push rod will get in there a little bit. It should not be able to bounce around like that, and that's what's making the tick. Now, to figure out exactly what the problem is, we're going to have to go a little bit deeper into the engine. And that's what I'm going to walk you through pretty quick here. We're set up. Before we go into this too much deeper, we want to see if there's any other cylinders that have an issue. I've run a compression test and a lot of the cylinders are still very good. So those cylinders you don't really have to worry about too much. There's a couple cylinders that are a little bit low. So what we're going to do now is we're going to turn the engine over by hand. You see down there I've got the ratchet on the crank pulley. It's a 21 mil socket. And we're just going to turn it over, and what you're looking for is we're going to work our way back. We're going to watch the valves actuate. And once they've got zero lash, meaning they're at the top of the travel, just see if I can get the engine turn over a little bit here. Okay, right now you can see that this exhaust valve is moving on the number 2 cylinder. Once you've hit that point, and it's at the top, like it is now, you can check how much play it has in it. That's still pretty tight. It doesn't have much lash to it, so that one I wouldn't be too worried about. Same with this one. And then you just want to keep working your way back. They kind of go in order. You can see the intake is now opening on the number 4 cylinder. You can see that. Okay, so we got this at the top of its travel. It's got a little bit of play in it, but not too bad. That's about where it should be. Just rock it back and forth a little bit, trying to keep my fingers of the picture. And I'm not going to bore you by going through each and every one of these, but you're just going to keep working your way. Once the valve gets back to the top of its travel, you can just give it a little shake. See how much play is in it. It should not be able to move up and down when it's at at the top like that. You don't want the valve spring compressed at all. Okay, here we are looking at the number two cylinder, and we're on the exhaust valve now. As you can see, there's a fair bit of play back and forth, and there's just a little bit of play up and down. So that's not as tight as it should be, and likely what's happened is I've been finding that these push rods wear out. I found them up to a 16th of an inch shorter than they should be from the factory, and that gives you a little bit of slop. So we might not have a lifter problem, we might not have a cam problem. It's very possible we have a push rod problem, and we'll look into that once we get things apart. Okay, so I've gone through and I've checked the valve lash on the intakes and exhaust. Found a few loose ones. Remember, this is still a hydraulic roller lifter engine, so some will be a little bit loose because the oil pressure is down. But we're looking for the ones that are excessively loose. Next thing we're going to do is we're going to start working on taking the intake manifold off. I know I have to go deeper into this engine, so I got to get the intake manifold out of the way. There's a few things that you want to disconnect and a few things to be cautious of. One of the main things is at the back of the intake, you have your runner adjuster, and that has a connector on it. And if you can't really see it, you don't know it's there. If you lift your intake off and give it a yank, you're going to bust it. So we'll go through that when we start pulling this intake off. Okay, so we're looking at the intake. One of the things we want to do is we want to get some of the wiring off and out of the way. Certain things like the breather line, the vacuum line, some of those, just check them out. They don't necessarily have to come off. Some of these wiring connectors do. And we'll go through how to release the fuel injectors. You see there's a red lock, double lock here. Just kind of pry up on that. I'll get in a little bit closer. I apologize, I'm just holding a camera phone. So I'll just lift that up. You can see the connector's up. Then you press on the black portion right there, pull the connector off. Repeat that for all 8 injectors. Okay, we're back still working on the intake. One thing I want to show you on this particular intake is there's a couple bolts that you want to get off so you can get this air conditioning bracket off that holds some of the wiring. See the bracket here? Let's see if we can get a little bit better look at it. See the brackets right here? It's got one bolt holding it on that goes right there. Pull that out. That's a 13 mil. That one's pretty easy to see. The other one's a little trickier. It's down here. You can see the nut right there, also 13 mil. You want to remove both of those so you can get that bracket out of the way. I've already kind of loosened it off, so we'll just get it out of the way here. Sorry about the picture of the back of my hand with the glove on it, but just a second, and there we got it off, and that bracket now come out of the way. Okay, and that can just move out of the way. You don't need to take it right off. I just want to point out one of the habits I kind of got into. When you're taking everything apart, there's a couple ways to do things with the hardware. One of the better ways is to take some bags, put the hardware in it, label it for what it's for. One of the other ways I do it is if you don't have any bags around, if the bolt can go back in, put it back where it's supposed to go without the bracket there, and that gives you a good idea of where everything's supposed to go, and it keeps it with the items so you don't lose the hardware. So I put the bolt back in just finger tight. And I've also put our nut back in down here. I don't know if you can see it. Yes, there it is right there. Put that back on, just finger tight. The next thing I'm going to do when removing this intake manifold, so I'm going to remove the bolts for the intake, which you can see down here. There's 5 on each side. One there, a couple more towards the back. And you want to take them off in a kind of a spiral pattern. So I'm going to start with this one in the middle, then I'm going to move over to the one on that side, then to that side, just go behind it, come back over to this side, and just keep kind of working my way around in a spiral pattern. What that does is it prevents from warping anything and helps things assemble in the future. The other thing I'm going to do is I'm going to leave the fuel line on until I'm just about ready to take the manifold off, because frankly I don't like the smell of gas and I want to prevent it for as long as possible. If you need to depressurize the fuel line, one of the things you can do is pull the fuse for the fuel pump and crank the engine over till it will no longer run. Now on this truck, the fuel pump motor is fuse F70. You can see it there. I'm just holding the light here, but I'll see if I can point to it. Right there, F70 fuel pump motor. Come over to your diagram. I'm trying to keep the light there, and you can see the F70 right there. So we come down here and look, according to our map, this 30 amp breaker, and that also matches the literature, is our fuel pump. Sorry, not breaker, fuse. That's our fuse. We're going to pull that fuse out. That'll stop power from the fuel pump, and then we can finish cranking the engine. Okay, so here we go. We're going to take the manifold off, the intake manifold. These are just a little number 8 head, and there's not a lot of torque on these. I think it's approximately 105 inch-pounds. So I'm just using a quarter inch drive ratchet. Don't need to overdo it. And you're just going to work your way around like I showed you earlier. Okay, here I've got the intake manifold partially removed because I wanted to show you that connector I was talking about on your intake runner adjusters. So we're going to go in behind here. We'll see if we can get a look at it. And there we are right there. You can see that connector right there. Now, if you pull too hard on this, you're going to end up breaking that. And you want to be very careful. Luckily on the newer trucks, they made the wiring harness longer and you can pull this out a little farther and get at it fairly easily. You can see I got quite a bit of room there. If you're working on the 09 trucks, and I think maybe even 2010, that is a very short harness and it's very easy to break. So you're going to have to pretty much take it off and sit you. There is a mod to, or a service bulletin to address that. Not really sure on the number, but as long as you're careful, you can get it off. And while you have it off, you might want to put that extension harness on there so you don't run into problems with the harness breaking, because that is a problem on some of these trucks. Okay, let's carry on and get this intake off. Okay, we have our intake off. You can see your heads there. Looks like we had some furry friends visiting underneath the intake. That's fairly common, actually. See their handiwork here. So we're going to clean all that up. Right now we're going to be very careful not to drop anything down the intake ports. We're going to clean around them and then we're going to tape them up so we don't get anything in there. So I'm going to go ahead and do that. I'm not going to bore you with all the details. And when we come back, you'll see that's all cleaned up. Okay, there you go. We got it all cleaned up a little bit. I got some duct tape on there. It's your friend when you're doing stuff like that. Sorry, I was spraying a little brake clean there. Get a little frog in my throat sometimes with that. Let's see what else we got in here. Well, we have our cylinder deactivation solenoids right here. One there, one there, one there, and one there. Up here we have our cam phaser. So this is kind of some of the other stuff that's under the intake manifold if you ever need to get at it. We're not going to be touching any of that today. We're going to be now concentrating back onto the heads. They're starting to look a little dirty, but that's okay. We're going to be pulling them off, cleaning them up. So the next thing we're going to do is we're going to get the rocker shafts out. And then we can pull the push rods and you can see what type of shape they're in. Okay, before we get too much farther, I'm going to want to drain the radiator because we're going to need that empty if we're going to be pulling the heads off. We're going to come down to the radiator drain on these trucks. It's down here on the driver's side. So we'll get down there for you. It's a little washed out by the light, but it's right there. That is a 18 millimeter. What I like to do is I like to put a little tube on the bottom. There's a little spigot that it drains out of. So we just put a little hose there and we'll empty that into a clear jug. That way we can see how full it's getting. I just like to use an old water jug, antifreeze jug. Something that's clear, you can see what's going on. One thing I do want to mention is you got to be careful with that drain. If you pull it out too far, you're going to have a heck of a mess on your hands. So just be cautious when you're loosening it off. Don't let it come out too far. And you can kind of see my hose there going into the clear jug again. And that's all there is to it for draining the radiator. Okay, here we are back on the rocker shafts. We're about to take them off. It's just a 10 millimeter. And you want to be careful with these that you take them off evenly. And what I mean by that is start with the center crack crack it, move to the next bolt, move back to that bolt, move to the next one, move to the one at the back. Take them off evenly all the way through until there's no tension left on them. Otherwise, you will bend this shaft, and you're going to be looking at replacing that. So I'm going to get started and do that. There is a little bit of torque on these when you first crack them loose. So I'm going to need both hands. Okay, I've got all five cracked loose, so now I'm going to show, I want to show this because it's rather important. We're just going to give it a few twists, move on to the next one. Move on to the next one. We're going to keep repeating this pattern. Until we get the shaft to the point where it's ready to come off and there's no tension left on any of these, and then we can just loosen them off by hand. I'm going to go ahead and keep on doing that, and then I'm going to do the exhaust rockers and we'll catch up with you later. Okay, here we go. We got the rocker shafts out and we've got the push rods out. I like to organize them. I just use these old egg cartons to label them as to what cylinders they go. As you can see, there's a length difference in the intake push rod versus the exhaust push rods. But there is something else I'd like to show you, and I mentioned it earlier, that these push rods have some tendencies to wear. And this is one of the things that give you your Hemi tick. So let's take a push rod that's in good shape, and we'll look at it. And you can see the ball on both ends, or I don't have this cleaned up yet. It's in pretty good shape. Comparing that to one of the ones here, you can see that end is worn out. You can see the difference between the two. I'll put them side by side. So there's the two. See, the ball on that end's pretty good shape. We'll come down here and you can see there's a significant difference between these. One is very worn out. So let's do some measuring and see what we've got. Okay, so there you go. And you can see there's just about a 16th of an inch difference. The good push rods, just a little over 8 inches, and the bad push rods, just a little shy of 8 inches. So that is one of the problems that we have. And I had one engine where all the push rods were worn like that, intake and exhaust. So let's continue on getting into this engine a little bit more. We'll see how the lifters and stuff look. For that, we're going to need to take the head off. So a couple more things we wanted to look at is, one is you can see the oil passage going through the push rod there. It's fairly open and decent on this side. We flip this around to the worn end and look at that, almost non-existent now, just a pinhole. It should look like that. So let's put this back with our other push rods. And let's have a look at the rocker. So we know that this was the number four exhaust was the one we were having a problem with. Sorry, I think these are flipped around, so that's probably number four. So we're going to look at that. And you see how beat up that is? Don't know if it shows very well in the on the camera here, but let's take a look at some of these other ones. I'll just clean that up a little bit. See, these are pretty beat up. You can feel the roughness on these pads. Yeah, they're pretty chewed up. So we're gonna have to replace those rockers as well. Well, this one's not as bad, and this one's even a little bit better yet. So these two aren't too bad. Just a little bit of on there, and that one, that's pretty good. So that is not good, and nor is that. So we're going to be wanting to replace those rockers as well. Okay, the next part of this operation, and get the head off, is to get the exhaust manifold off. Now I got the wheel well out so that you can see this. It's not necessary to take it out. You can get this out without taking the wheel well out. One thing I will point out is we got a broken exhaust stud at the back here. That's a very common issue on these trucks. Don't worry about it. We're going to get that out later. But the first step is taking off this heat shield here. It's held on by 4 10 millimeter nuts. One here, one down here, and a couple more at the front. There and down there. Once you get those off, you should be able to just pull the exhaust shield off. Might have to wiggle it out, but I'm going to need both hands for this. Okay, and there we have it. There's our exhaust shield, broken exhaust stud and all. So now that we have that out, we're going to continue on with the rest of the studs and in the manifold and the bolts. So let's get to work. So coming along here, you can see the manifold fairly clearly. There's one that it's kind of hard to see here, but that's a 10 millimeter bolt head. These exhaust studs will be a 13 mil. You can use a shallow socket on these ones. You will need a deep socket. Let's go to the front here where we haven't broken the bolt. There it is. You can see that's the one that'll need the 13 mil. There's four of those. And the rest will just need a 10 mil. Okay, I'm going to get to that. Again, going to need both hands. And I believe there's 1, 2, 3, 4 on the top, 4 on the bottom. So I'll be back in a bit. Okay, there we go. We got the rocker shafts off both sides of the engines. We got the push rods. Again, I want to show you something. This time it's on the intake push rods on the driver's side. And you can see there's almost 1/8 of an inch difference there. That's a lot when you're talking the close tolerance of these newer valve trains. So it's no wonder we're getting a lot of noise out of this engine. We're definitely going to have to replace some push rods. I do have a set on order. You can get them from Mopar themselves. It cost me about $120 Canadian. Our American friends, it should be around 80 bucks or something like that. So yeah, that's quite amount of wear there. Okay, here we are back on the head. I've got the exhaust manifold off. On some of the older trucks, are going to have a grounding or bonding strap back of the head. This one doesn't have it, so we're okay there. And on the other side, there's some brackets and stuff. You'll have to pull some bolts out. I'm going to continue working on this side because it's easier to show you everything. So, next important thing. When you're taking these heads off, you want to do it in a specific order. Follow the reverse pattern of the torque sequence. So, the torque sequence is basically, again, surprise, surprise, a spiral. So you go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. And then you've got your little guys up here, and you're going to work from the middle, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17. I think you can kind of see the little guys on this side. They're hiding out under the tape. I'll cut that out of the way later. So when you're doing this, you're going to crack each one loose. You're not going to take it all the way out. And then once you have them all cracked loose, then you can start taking them all the way out. Again, you do not want to warp heads. This is aluminum, and that's why you do it in a sequence. Let's go to our next tool tip here. There we go. This is a breaker bar. That is a torque wrench. Do not use the torque wrench to take the heads off. That's for putting them on. Use your breaker bar. That'll be plenty of force to help get the bolts loose. It's a 15 mil socket. I use a 15 mil deep impact socket. Doesn't look like it's an impact socket because all the black's worn off. I've used it quite a bit. Okay, I'm going to get started on the head. We'll see you guys in a little while. Okay, I've gone through and I've cracked all the bolts loose. I think I said there were 17 fasteners earlier. There's only 15. My bad. There's 10 of these larger. I think they're... Well, I'm not going to say. I think the 10 of the larger bolts, and there is 5 of the smaller bolts. So now, look, that's pretty loose. I've cracked them all loose. Again, I'm going to follow the pattern. Once you got them cracked loose, it's pretty easy just to get them to the point where they're hand tight with the ratchet. Just using a half inch drive ratchet here. And I'm just going to keep going around until they're all finger tight, and then we'll pull them up by hand.
Okay, here we go. We've got most of the head bolts out. I've left the one little guy in just to keep the head in place. Probably doesn't need it because it's got the dowel pins. But I want to explain something and clear up some misconceptions. These are the Hemi head bolts. They are torqued to angle or torqued to turn. What these are, an LS GM head bolt. These are torqued to yield. So what does that mean? Is there a difference? Yes, there is. Torque to yield means that the shank area of the bolt right here stretches beyond what it's supposed to stretch. That means that this bolt is not reusable. The Hemi bolts are torqued to angle. They do not necessarily exceed their maximum yield. That means that these bolts are reusable. Now, little disclaimer here, make sure you always check the manufacturer's material. If you're not comfortable reusing these, that's okay. They're not that expensive. I think you can get a whole set for an engine for about $50 Canadian. So go ahead and buy some new ones if you want. But these are reusable bolts. That's not to say they don't need to be inspected. You can reuse them though. Okay, and there you go. We've got the head off. Let's see, everything looks to be in pretty good shape. Now, these multi-layer steel gasket, MLS gaskets as they call them, they are supposedly reusable. I have done it in a pinch, and the car is still running fine after 4 years. That being said, I don't recommend it. These things are inexpensive. Just buy some new gaskets and replace them if you know you're going in the engine. So, talking about the rest of the engine, we're getting close to what we're after here. We've got the cylinder head off. You can see the cylinders and the pistons. And right here is where we're going next. We're going for the lifters. There's a little 8mm bolt that retains these cups. We're going to pull those off, then we can get at the lifters. On this, if memory serves, the MSD lifter, so the multi-cylinder displacement or multi-displacement system, depending on which manufacturer you're talking. On this engine, I believe it's cylinders 1, 7, 2, and 6. I can confirm this side's 2 and 6 right there. If you have the engine with the MDS system, the lifters and retainers are different than a non-MDS system. So make sure, like, for example, if you're working on a half ton compared to a 3/4 ton engine, these will be different. Be aware of that. Okay, I've already pulled out the lifters for this side, and I got a pleasant surprise. Looks like we might only have a collapsed lifter rather than a worn camshaft lobe. So we might not even have to pull the cam out of this engine. I'm going to still run a bore scope down the hole and just check the cam out as best I can. You can get a cheap bore scope if you're in Canada, Princess Auto carries them. If you're in the States, I think the equivalent is Harbor Freight. And so just pull the lifters out. There we go. Oh, they didn't all come out with the cups. Try that again. Take that out like that, and we'll pull them out individually. Notice the orientation of the lifter when you take it out. Also a good reason for recording. This is an MDS lifter. You can see the mechanism inside there is a little bit different, and it's flat at the top. It's not tapered. I'll show you the difference between the two in a second here. So the two MDS lifters are going to come out here. A little bit of friction on them. There we go. Non-MDS lifter. Let's have a little closer look at that. See, it's got a little bit of a taper at the top there, and the design's a little bit different inside, internally.
I'm going to finish pulling all these out, and then I'll show you what I found.
Okay, there we go. We get the lifters out. We've got them organized. And if you recall, when we started this job, the problem was on number 4 cylinder. So this is the front. I've got them labeled there. So bearing that in mind, these would be the number 4 lifters. Common failure on these Hemi engines is these rollers seize up and they wipe out the cam. Now, we don't seem to have that problem here. What we have is a collapsed lifter. So if you look at this lifter, you can see that should be flush. The little cup inside there should be at least flush with the top of the lifter. Let's just pull the other one out here for comparison. You can see how much closer the cup is to being flush with the top, or nearly flush. Let's have a look at them side by side. And you can see that that cup's quite a bit higher in this lifter here. You can see how far down it is. So that's what, that combined with the push rod is what was causing us our very nasty tick. And we're gonna take a little bit deeper look into the engine. We'll use the borescope for that and see what we come up with, but we might have just got lucky and we might not be pulling that cam out. Okay, so just in case some of you are wondering what it looks like when a cam does get wiped out, this is not out of this truck, this is out of another truck that I was working on. We'll come down to this lobe right there, and that's what happens. When that roller seizes, wipes the lobe right out. You can see there's not much left of that. Takes out the lifter, takes out the cam lobe, and that's what you're left with. Fortunately, we don't have that, at least not yet. I still got to check the other side. Okay, now we're going to get ready to start putting things back together. We know what the problems are. And for this, that is your friend. We're going to clean the head surface and the block surface with your razor blade. Just take it and you just scrape it along like you're shaving. Just like that. You just do that a few times to get it all off. And when you've got most of the big stuff off, you just wipe her down with some brake clean. And you'll be ready to start putting stuff back together. Okay, here we go. We got our cylinder head cleaned up. I just want to show you one other thing before we go and reinstall it. Is you want to check your valve springs. Make sure none of them are broken. Best way to do this is just grab them and try to turn them. If they turn easily, then you've got a broken valve spring. But these seem to be good. We took the broken exhaust stud out. We cleaned up all the surfaces. Blown out the ports so that there's nothing in there. You can see the valves in there. Looks pretty clean. Don't have the best light, but there you go. That one nice and clean in there. We cleaned off the back side of the head. Just using some brake clean and a razor blade. So it's about ready to go back on. Just got to finish cleaning up the block.
So the next thing we're going to do is we're going to blow out all the head bolt holes. Make sure there's no oil and antifreeze or water or anything in there. Is what that can do is fluid is non-compressible, and if you end up putting too much pressure on the bolt with some fluid, especially oil, you potentially crack your block. What I do is I just take my air hose, turn the pressure way down, and normally I have a rag over top so it doesn't make a huge mess, but I want to show you this. Make sure you get a mask on so you can, that's good for vapors, because when you blow that out you're going to get some mist. And here we go. You see all that coming out of there? Wipe that down. You want to get as much out as you can and then move on to the next one. Just be careful on the bottom because some of those are coolant passages and the other ones are the bolt holes. You'll know when you hit the wrong one, trust me. And get as much of that out as possible. I made a bit of a mess, I got to get to clean it up. Okay, here we go. We're going to put the lifters back in. We got a thin little film of oil on them. We don't want to over oil them because we don't want them dripping all over the surfaces we just cleaned. We're just going to kind of line them up. Just like that. And there they go. They're home. Then we're going to put the little bolt in. I like to put a little bit of blue light Loctite on that. And we're going to look up the torque specs. I'll let you know what that is. And we're looking pretty good.
Okay, so there we go. We got a little bit of blue thread locker on there. I think I called it Loctite earlier, but that's just a brand.
So we're going to put that in there. Going to torque these to,
well, I torque them to 108 inch pounds, but make sure you look up the manufacturer's information, see what they say. There we go, clicky click. Back one here. Oh, didn't quite have that one in as tight. Don't like using the torque wrench as a ratchet, but in this case, we'll make it happen. Click, there we go. So that's that. The lifters are back in. Okay, there you go. We got the new head gasket sitting on there. I've got each of the pistons in the hole a little bit. Put just a light film of oil on there. Make sure that they've got a little bit of lubrication when we start this up. And I'm going to go grab the head and we're going to put that on. Okay, there we go. We got the head sitting back on there. I just want to show you one thing. I left this one bolt out. I cleaned all the bolts up. I've especially cleaned the head of the bolt, and I'll show you why later on in the video. But it's important to get the head clean, it's free of grease and everything else, and it is also important to get the threads and everything clean. They should also thread in easily by hand because you've already blown out all the holes. There should be no water or oil in there. So when you run these in, if you've done everything okay, it should just spin in no problem, very freely. Until you hit right there. There we go. Okay. If you run into a problem where you can feel the bolt loading up, take it out. See how much fluid's on the threads. You can probably just clean them up and run a tap down there or run the bolt down a few times and pull all the rest of the fluid out. Don't try to torque it if it's loading up on you because you could damage your engine. So now we're going to torque these. This is a three-stage torque. Again, always follow the manufacturer's recommendation. I'm just going to use good old Mr. Clicky torque wrench for the first couple. Sorry, finger got in there a bit. This big guy here, Mr. Clicky. He doesn't have to be deadly accurate because these are torque to turn, meaning we're going to do a base torque, and then from that base torque, we're going to turn it 90 degrees. Again, three stages. So the first setting is 25 foot-pounds on the big guy. And we're going to go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. And we're going to come up here. And I believe it's a very low setting on here. Maybe 10 foot-pounds. I'll have to double-check that for the first torque. So that's going to be 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. Then we're going to do it all again. This time we're going to torque these to 45 foot-pounds. And again, 1, 2, 3, 4, follow your pattern. As long as it's a spiral pattern, you should be okay. But if you get the manufacturer and they've got it laid out, go ahead, follow it. And then these go up to, I think, 15 foot-pounds. And you torque them. And then we're going to mark the bolt heads just for security and safety in case we lose track. And we're going to put a vertical line on each bolt head. Because the third stage is torquing these 90 degrees. And I do have a digital torque wrench with angle, and I will be using that. But it's a little tricky to use at some point, so I like to have the mark on here as a backup. We cannot mark these until we get them torqued to 45. That's why I haven't marked them yet. And then we're going to follow our pattern again, 90 degrees. And then these will get torqued, I think, 15. And then we're done. She's torqued on.
Okay, there we go. We've done both stages of the initial torquing. So 25 in the pattern. Then I did look these up. I was wrong the first time. They're 15 foot-pounds. If you don't have a torque wrench that goes that low, don't worry. You can convert that to inch-pounds.
by timesing by 12, so 174 inch pounds. Use that torque wrench. I did the second, which is 45 foot pounds on here in the pattern. And then you repeat the 174 inch pounds up here, or 15 foot pounds. Now we got Mr. Torquey on there, who will track degrees. We're looking for 90 degrees. But as a backup, like I said before, I like to take a marker and mark the bolt heads of a vertical line. So go in here, just make a line like that. And you can see the line pretty clear. I'm going to go through and I'm going to mark all the bolt heads now that I have them torqued to 45. And when that line goes from vertical to horizontal, well, we've got 90 degrees. So that's our backup, just in case. Okay, let's see how we did here. Yeah. And they all look pretty good. You see all our lines are now horizontal instead of vertical. We need to go a couple more degrees on that one, but so the final torque sequence is done, except for these little guys up here, which I have to still go through. They're 25 foot pounds now. So I'm gonna start in the middle, go 1, 2, 3, go back to the big torque wrench with some adapters. We'll get that done.
Okay, so I went and picked up some new push rods at my local Chrysler dealer, and look at that. Even one of the better ones. The new ones are still longer.
Okay, there we go. We started putting the first rocker shaft back in. I put the new exhaust push rods in. You can see them in there. Already, I haven't even tightened this down. This thing's already way better. So again, we're going to tighten it in a sequence because we don't want to bend the shaft. I've used lots of engine pre-assembly lube. So that's a good idea. Put it on the tips of the valves, the both ends of the push rods, and in the cradle here. And I'll show you that a little bit later when I do the top one. It's a little easier to see. But we're going to start torquing these down, give that a couple turns, then move that one, then that one, then that one, then that one. And we're going to keep that pattern up until we seat it. And then these get torqued to about 16 foot-pounds, I believe. Okay, that worked really well. If you remember all the slop we had, I can't even move that now. That's a little bit on that one, a little bit on that one. But you can see they're a lot tighter than when we started, so it's about zero lash on these now, which is awesome. There's no play of them in any of them whatsoever. And that's exactly what we're going for. That should quiet this engine right up. Okay, you can see I've got some lubrication there, on the new push rods right there, right here. And we're going to put the rocker shaft in. And you got to be a little careful with the top one because you got to, as you're tightening it down, make sure that the ball stays in the cup of the rocker. So just be aware of that as you're going. And always keep an eye on these and check them as you tighten the rocker shaft down. Okay, I'm going to try to do this with one hand and video it at the same time. A little tricky, but not impossible, I'm thinking. Did a couple turns on that. A couple turns on that one. Move that one. It's pretty loose. Okay. Get a little tension on there. So now I'm going to go through and I'm going to check that my push rods are all in the cup of the rocker. You just reach in with your finger here and you should be able to. That one's got some pressure on it, but it's in there. That one's starting to get pressure on it. That's good. And I'm just going to keep repeating that pattern. We're going to tighten down a couple turns, a little bit at a time. So we don't bend the shafts, and we're going to keep checking our rockers as we go until we actually bottom out, and then we can torque it up. Should be good. Again, finger back here. Now I've got these all trapped. They don't seem to be moving too far, and there's not enough play. Oh yeah, they're starting to get good tension on them already. The other thing I'll do is I'll crank the engine over by hand a couple times, make sure everything's moving how it's supposed to be. That's the best time to do it, because if it's going to jam up, you want it to jam up with your hand pressure, not with the starter. That's when things get wrecked. Okay, we got everything installed on this side. The shaft's torqued down. I'm going to come down here, crank the engine over by hand. Like I said, keep an eye on everything, make sure nothing binds up. Okay, I've already done a little bit of this already. So everything's turning really nice. You can see the valve compressing there and coming back up. We've got lots of tension on all the shafts, all the rockers, so that's looking good. So I'm going to do one more torque check and make sure that everything's, now that we've gone through, everything's still nice and tight. Everything's exactly where I left it here, so it's a good sign. Well, next thing we're going to do is we're going to put the valve cover back on so that we can prevent any garbage from falling in here, now that we got it all cleaned and lubed up. Okay, there we go. We got the valve covers back on. Just working on getting the intake on. The only thing I wanted to point out is remember those two connectors at the back here for the intake runners, and I believe the top one up there is the, you can't really see it because I got no light on there, but right there, I believe that's the map sensor. I'll have to confirm that. Then hook up your injector wiring and remember to torque it in a spiral pattern. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, you know, go around and work your way out and you should be good. I believe the torque is 108 inch pounds.
So someone might have deleted some of his content, and this is what I've got to replace it with. So I've just got a little clip of the engine running, and I've got a few shots of the truck's bodywork. In this picture, you can see that I'm working on the fender. It's got a little rust spot. There, we've got it treated and primed and blended and prepped. And in this picture, I'm trying out the replacement bumper, just bought a used one. You can see it's blue, so we're going to have to get rid of that. Sanded it down. Next, we're going to just put on a coat of primer. Show you the top side as well. And now I've got the base coat on it, and we're just test fitting it on the truck to see how everything's looking. So far, it's matching up pretty good. And there's the final product with the clear coat and the plastic step pad. Here's a couple of finished pictures of the truck. I did manage to get the instrument cluster sorted out. I did have to go and buy one from an auto wrecker. And as long as you can get one that has around the same mileage, it's plug and play. You just put it on and away you go. If not, you're just going to have to record the mileage difference and keep a log of that. Worked pretty good. Couple of shots of the interior and the final shot of the truck. So I hope you enjoyed this video.